Hi, this is Dr. Anthony Earl, and this is our fourth part on our series of Tabernacling with God. We hope that the previous three teachings helped you to kind of get an idea of what to do to create a place for you and God to have fellowship. God is interested in fellowshipping with you. And so let's go back to our text out of Exodus 33, beginning at verse 7. It says, "And Moses took his tent and pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. And it came to pass that everyone who sought the Lord went out to the Tabernacle of Meeting, which was outside the camp. So it was, whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle, that all the people rose, and each man stood at his tent door and watched Moses until he had gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass, when Moses entered the tabernacle, that the pillar of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord talked with Moses." And so here we see that Moses pitched his tent outside of the camp. He moved from the distractions. He got into a place of solitude, a quiet place where he could have fellowship with God and receive instructions from God as to how to deal with a mass amount of people. Literally, Moses had to deal with over 1 million folk. So can you imagine how important it is to kind of get insights from God and wisdom from God as to how to lead a mass amount of people. So it was, whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle, that all the people rose and each man stood at his tent door and watched Moses until he had gone into the tabernacle. So as we established earlier, people are watching how we serve God. They're watching how we live. They're watching and studying us to see if really we are actually practicing what we say we believe. People are examining us. I shared earlier how I've watched people over my life, those who've practiced a lifestyle of fellowshipping with God, those who I knew were in pursuit of God, seeking God, going after God. And man, did I learn from them. I saw their fruit. I saw their exploits, the things that they were accomplishing in their walk. And so I patterned. I remember one day, real good friend of mine, back in my seminary days, who I began to develop a relationship with. He and I were praying in his home, and we were on our knees praying. And my spiritual language had not fully developed yet. And I took notice that when he was praying and listening to the sound of his prayer, man, it inspired me. And then after we had finished praying, I asked him, I said, "Can you help me to develop my prayer life like that?" And so we built relationships. We built our relationship, and it was like a mentoring. It was like an equipping, and we influenced each other. Our spiritual walk increased. We ended up planting churches around about the same time. Just so amazing, so amazing. People are watching. And the way we learn is by example, by modeling. And so we see in the scriptures the models we see Jesus as a model. And when you look at Jesus, he is giving reference to the Torah. So therefore, he is letting us know or cluing us to the fact that he studied men like Moses. He studied men like Enoch, a man who walked with God and was not. These are exemplary examples of people who built a system where God could come in and have fellowship with them and enrich their life, enrich their growth, enrich their development. So here the people are standing, they're watching, and there are some activities that are taking place. I mean, can you imagine? It's like a blockbuster movie. A lot of stuff is happening, man. The cloud of God has come down. There is some activity. Now, the people were already introduced to this cloud prior to Moses building this place called the Tabernacle of Meeting. They've already seen the cloud of God. They know a little bit about God's ways and how God handled things. And so here it says, whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle, all the people rose. So it's like when Moses went out to that tabernacle, people followed. I mean, people got into pursuit. People went after Moses. They knew that God would speak, and they were interested in discovering. And the scripture says something that's pretty interesting here. It says, those who sought him, you see, seek him while he may be found. Seek him. This is the time to seek God, because one day you're not going to be able to find him. Man, I tell you, I don't want to live a day without God being intimately involved in my life, helping me to grow and to mature and to enrich myself. Man, God is an awesome God. I love him. I love him to life. And so all the people rose. Each man stood at his tent door. So they got as close as they could. They came to the tent door because there were systems. There are systems that are designed by God where people cannot violate. I remember the story that at the mountain, God told them that no one could come to the mountain except for Aaron and Joshua. I mean, these are examples of limits that God sets, boundaries that God sets for his people. And so we discover that the people would come to the tent and they would watch Moses. They would study him. They would know. I mean, just amazing. Even as we read the New Testament scriptures, we see the same thing that's happening even as the temple and the temple of Herod and Zechariah goes in. And he has the rope and the bell on him so that as he is doing what he is called to do within that structure, the bell is ringing. And now he comes out and people watch him and they notice that he can't speak. He can't talk. And automatically they conclude he saw an angel. He had an encounter with God. So the people here in the book of Exodus are studying Moses because they know that God is giving them insight. And so we see that our lifestyles become the influencing mechanisms to draw people. The way you live become the influencing mechanism to draw people. So we're the light. Jesus says, you're like a light upon the hill. We're the lamps of God. We cannot be like the foolish virgins. We have to be like the wise virgins who are full of oil. The foolish virgins, they run out of oil. And so now they're trying to borrow oil from the wise virgins. And so when they go to look for the oil, the master comes. And the master invites those who have their lamps into the kingdom, and he shuts the door. And now the foolish virgins come and they cannot get in. We are the lights of God, and we should constantly have our lamps filled with the oil of God. And so we receive that oil by having fellowship with God, by spending time in the Word of God, by spending time speaking to God, praying and seeking God. We live in a society, we live in an environment where people don't pray. They go to church, but they don't pray. We live in a place where people go to church, but they don't read the Word of God. And they wonder why they're not having the successes in their lives, why they're not having the exploits that the Scripture speaks about. The Scripture says that the people that know their God shall be strong and do exploits. There are some exploits for you. There are some accomplishments for you. There are some victories for you. And no matter what you are encountering in your life, you can be victorious in Christ. The way we pursue God invokes a curiosity for others to want what we have. It invokes a curiosity. People are seeing the successes in our life. They are seeing the victories in our life, and they want it. I mean, I'm where I am because I want it. I read books like Smith Wigglesworth. I read those books about the healing ministry he had, and it stirred me. And I said, God, I want that. God, give that to me. Give it to me. I want to serve you. I want to be used by you. And guess what? God gives you the desires of your heart. Exodus 33:9 says, and it came to pass when Moses entered the tabernacle that the pillar of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle, and the Lord talked with Moses. Do you see that? That the people are standing at the door. They're watching Moses, and Moses goes in. And now the cloud of God, the glory cloud, comes and rests upon that tabernacle. It rests upon. You know, when you spend time with God, you may not feel as like you're anointed or that the glory of God is upon you. But I guarantee when God comes and visits you and dines with you and sups with you and have fellowship with you, you cannot leave that fellowship without being touched by him. When I come out to go out into the marketplace or to travel after prayer, I know the glory of God is upon my life. I know the presence of God. And so I do my best to represent him right. I do my best to be an encouragement to others. I smile. I encourage people. I greet people. I say nice things to people. I listen to hear the voice of God. Just the other day, as I was traveling to Europe, I boarded a plane. I was speaking to one of my sons in the faith. And as I was talking, I was ending the conversation, and I said that I made a statement that the people did not enter into their promise because they did not enter into his rest. And before I could speak rest, someone sitting on the plane quoted that part of the verse, and it blessed me. Just the quote, a part of a verse, to hear it out of another believer's mouth was an encouragement. And so I got off the phone, I sat down, and me and the brother in faith began to share scriptures and talk about God. And then a young lady came and we began to share scriptures. And a few moments before the plane was to land, I asked them, I said, well, what industry are you in? And they said, well, we're flight attendants. Isn't that amazing? I had an opportunity to encourage flight attendants, to tell them what a great job they're doing and how blessed we are to have great attendants who know God to serve us. And just that dynamic. And then I'm on board another plane heading to Europe. And now the flight is delayed, and it causes me to miss my connection. And so now I'm in another city, and I'm there for an extra hours, and I'm walking, and I'm being a blessing to other people, encouraging people, loving on people. And then I run into this senior, and she's on a phone that connects you to the baggage department, trying to locate her bags. And I was just on that phone trying to find my bags to make sure that I'm traveling with the bag. And so I give her advice. It says, well, they're not going to answer their phone. Let me show you the place to go. And so I showed her the place to go. And then someone comes out to help her. And they connect her with the man in the baggage department. And so he comes out, and he introduces himself to us, and he says to me, he says, I'm going to take her in first to find her bags, and I'll come back out and help you. And then he comes back out, and I go in, and within less than 2 minutes, there's my bag. I mean, it's just amazing when you spend time with God, he works things out. And so during all this time, I'm not flustered. I'm not bothered. I'm not anxious. I'm not worried. I know that everything is working according to God's plans. You know, me being there just to be kind to that woman could have made her day. I mean, I didn't get all spiritual with her, but I knew that I had spent time with God, I had tabernacled with God, I had gotten into my word, I've prayed, and now God is directing my steps. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. God, he directs our steps. He leads us, he guides us into all things. We talked about Matthew 6:33 as being one of those standard verses in our home. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Our lifestyles become the influencing mechanism that draw people to God. The way we behave, the way we carry ourselves. When we build a portal for God, his glory manifests. When we build a portal, his glory manifests. The cloud comes. God's presence gets on us. I remember times walking into a building and people look at me and say, there's something unique about you. Man, you're glowing. Are you a man of God? See, God's presence, because you spend time with him. When Moses entered the tabernacle, that the pillar of cloud descended. It came. When you set a time to pray and to seek God, he shows up. He shows up. When we enter into our secret place, God descends to come in and to fellowship with us. He comes to give us the bread of life. Have you noticed Jesus was teaching us the Lord's Prayer? He says, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. I want revelation. God, give me insight. My Father in heaven, give me insight. Because Jesus is thinking about Isaiah 55. As the rain, as the snow falls upon the earth to water the earth, it gives the buds. It gives the seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So God releases his word from his mouth and it never comes back to him void. Notice the cloud stood at the door, at the place where the people stood. At the place the cloud comes. Now the people see that there's divine activity that's taking place between Moses and God. Man, those who sought the Lord, I'm sure they're desiring to have the same fellowship, the same access. We are blessed. We are blessed. Because God set systems in place where they needed a mediator like Moses and Aaron and the Levites. But today, the Lord has removed those barriers and he's given us the access to God. They saw firsthand the divine activity of God with Moses. He spoke to Moses face to face, and the Lord talks to Moses, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace." I mean, God is teaching Moses how to be a blessing to people, how to make a decree over the lives of people. This is why we spend time with God. The word bless in the Hebrew is the word barak. It means empowered to prosper. God is empowering us to prosper. God is having fellowship with us so that he can equip us and give us the capacity and the ability to bless other people. The word bless is first used in Genesis 1:22. It says, "Be fruitful and multiply," systems that God established in the earth. "May his face shine." Make his face to shine upon you. This is critical. This is critical that you build a place of habitation for God to come in and to fellowship with you. He's looking to tabernacle with you. He's looking to have fellowship with you. He's looking to commune with you, to break bread with you, to give you insights, to equip you, to grow you. I mean, I find time with God. I remember I was in one of the most turbulent times in my life. And I remember during my prayer, weeping and asking God to change me, letting God know that I wanted to live right. I wanted to be right. Don't allow me to stray. Don't allow me to make missteps in my life. I don't want to be separated from you. I mean, just reading the scriptures when Jesus is being nailed on the cross, when he's suffering on the cross, and for him to feel as if he is alienated and separated from God. I don't ever want to experience that. And so therefore, I wept and I asked God, God, renew in me the right spirit. I see, I'm reading David. I'm reading the Psalms. I'm reading Psalm 51. Renew in me the right spirit. Create in me a clean heart. Oh, God, cleanse me. Make me as white as snow. And so I'm pursuing God. So when I see snow, I get excited. Because I'm seeking God and I'm asking God that my lifestyle, my behavior, the way I function, the way I walk would be whiter than snow. So I'm constantly interrogating myself. I encourage you to interrogate yourself, to examine yourself, and to begin to weed out of your life the barriers, the things that hinder your relationship with God. Do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. These are critical, critical things to install in your life. And when you do that, you find yourself growing and maturing in God. God is so gracious, so faithful to us. I know you've heard a lot these past four teachings, so much. I encourage you to go back and listen to them over. Listen to them. And as you listen, also listen to the voice of God. Listen to God addressing certain issues in your life. God dealing with your own insecurities and your fears, your doubts, your unbelief. As I close, I'm reminded of this father who brings his son to the disciples of Jesus. This father who's concerned about his son's epileptic son. He's concerned about his epileptic son. And so he says to Jesus, he said, "I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him." And so Jesus says, you faithless generation, you perverse generation. And so he challenges them. And now the disciples, after Jesus heals the boy, the disciples wants to know why couldn't they do it. And Jesus says, "This kind comes out except through fasting and prayer. And so when we build a place for God to come in, to equip us, to change us, there are things that we have to do. We have to pray. And praying without the word of God is like a car that does not have gasoline. You can't get anywhere. Every prayer should be infused with the word of God. Well, we want to just encourage you to start practicing daily prayer. I would encourage you to do it in the morning, because the psalmist says, early will I rise, early will I rise. So right there, we find out that part of the principles is to start off the day seeking God. And so we ask that you would create that place. Well, blessings to you. We're out of time. Blessings and grace to you. And we encourage you to just build your own unique relationship with God. Allow God to grow you so that other people who are watching you can desire what you have, and you can be an instrument that God will use to help them to get it. We love you. We thank you for tuning in, and may the Lord richly bless you, and may the Lord walk with you as you grow in Him. This is Dr. Anthony Earl, and until next time, may He richly bless you. That's good, man.